These guys do. I mean, they have a lot to say, but they were just saying they really want to hear you talk more than they want to hear themselves. So they're going to talk for a little bit, and then there'll be ample time for questions. We'll probably try to do the questions over here as we did for the earlier two panels, but they don't really need an introduction. I mean, Dave Zirin, the one thing I'd say about him, he's, I think I mentioned this earlier, The Nation is America's oldest weekly magazine, now in our 151st year. Dave is the first sports editor in the magazine's illustrious history, so he's brought so much to sort of the magazine through his exploration of race and class and gender through the lens of sports. It's been really meaningful to the magazine. Many of you probably know us from thenation.com. On thenation.com, I don't want to swell his head, but he is the most popular writer we have. Nobody reads, nobody has read more at thenation.com than Dave's work, and so we're very pleased to have him. Sean Jacobs is a professor here at the New School. He's representing the New School today, and we're very happy to have him. Many of you have probably heard of a blog that he started called Africa is a Country, which started in a much smaller form, he was telling us earlier. It's a really important read, so if you don't know it now, you should check it out. He also has a long history of investigating the way sports is used as a colonial tool, as a political tool, and so they're going to talk about that for a little bit, and then, again, take your questions. So thank you, and Dave and Sean.
Cool.
Thank you.
Thanks. Hey, Sean, before we start, can I tell these guys a story real quick?
Go ahead.
All right, man. I just want to tell y'all a story real quick. This is a true story. I wrote a book, and this is the book that really helped me get established here at The Nation. It was called What's My Name, Fool? Sports and Resistance in the United States. And the cover is a big picture of Muhammad Ali's face, like a big Ali face. And I went to this bookstore in a city to do a talk. I don't want to name the city. All right, it was Philadelphia. And went into Philly, this store, and I said, hey, I'm here to do, I'm Dave Zirin. I'm here to do What's My Name, Fool talk. And the guy behind the counter, he looked at me and he said, but you're white. And I said, well, yeah, last I checked, I am white. And he said, but isn't that you on the cover of the book? And I was like, no, that's Muhammad Ali. Now this was a very left-wing kind of bookstore, and there were like posters up of people like Malcolm X and Emma Goldman, and I remember being so stunned that the most famous draft resister in the history of war was not readily familiar to somebody who worked in such a radical space. And that's really been the mission of, I think, what I've tried to do with The Nation, and what I think the mission of really future journalism is going to be, which is to break out of the boxes they try to put us in and try to connect different areas of scholarship for the purposes of expanding the minds of readers about concepts of justice and concepts of the kind of world we want to live in. And there's this Gerald Early, who's a great academic who's written a lot about Ali. He, in writing about Ali, he said that America is a country devoted to the death of the paradox. And this idea of Ali being a paradox, because he was a boxer, but he also hated war. You know, that he was somebody who loved to speak, but he had difficulty reading. Someone who was utterly brilliant, but who was chastised for his absence of intelligence, but who was more correct on questions of war and racism than the best and brightest who were in the Johnson administration. So you have this, you know, incredible paradox of a human being. And I think that's what we should strive to be as journalists. And don't let yourself be put in a box. Don't be afraid to be a paradox. And to be the kind of writer you want to be, and then fight for that space in a journalism world that right now is in a profound period of flux. So that's just what I wanted to say that. Sorry, Sean.
I mean, maybe what I could do as a, by way of introduction, is just to sort of say how I relate, like, how is it that I relate to sport? Like, why I think sport's important? I think it's like very obvious. I was born in South Africa. So I think that's kind of like the way I come at these things. I was born in Cape Town in South Africa. I spend like kind of now as I'm getting older and older and older, almost I spent like my first 25 years of my life under apartheid, you know, like grew up under apartheid. So how does this relate to sport? Well, sport was like a major part, firstly, in the way that the apartheid state operated. I mean, this is, for some of you, I don't know how much you know about South Africa, but in the way that the apartheid state thought about power, thought about kind of keeping power, reinventing power, was largely also related to sport. So the apartheid state, there was a number of sports that they looked at, like rugby in particular, and cricket. And they tied their success or their ability to govern black people also with their success on the sports field, particularly rugby. So there's a way in which it sports bolsters like oppression, but then at the same time, sport was also seen as something that was part of the anti-apartheid struggle. So by the late 1970s, the ANC, which was a dominant movement at that time in South Africa, the ANC is in a bit of a trouble right now, but the ANC at that time was the dominant sort of expression of resistance against apartheid, were involved in an armed struggle. But they realized that armed struggle wasn't working that much because you had to convince Westerners, you had to convince Western governments, and they did sort of a two-prong strategy. The one was they began to like focus on like one individual. So they, Nelson Mandela, became like the figure that most people associated with South African struggle. So people started forgetting, I mean, this is just a little footnote, that not Nelson Mandela wasn't necessarily the only person on Robben Island, but in the way that most people understood the struggle in South Africa is that they thought about Nelson Mandela when they thought about South Africa. So, Free Mandela became sort of the predominant like slogan against apartheid. Concerts were organized around it. Sportsmen started to identify with it. People who know football, Ruud Gullit, the great Dutch footballer, when he won his World Football of the Year award, he handed it. He said, I want to give this, to Mandela. But the second part of this was sports became also a central part of the strategy against apartheid. Mm-hmm. So if running an armed struggle might turn off Westerners or people who may, sort of feel weird about people using arms in their struggle, well, what if you target sports? And so since dating back to the 1960s, and I know you've written about Tommy Smith and John Carlos, like the Olympics in Mexico was the first Olympics where South Africa was barred from participating in the Olympics. Dennis Brutus was like a figure from that moment. And so people targeted the Olympics. Then they targeted FIFA, which was the football. And by 1976, FIFA kicked South Africa out of the world body for football. And then finally, by the 1980s, the sports sanctions movement became like the dominant way of like opposing apartheid. And why did it work? It became so white South Africans and the ability of the South African state to kind of, as I said, reinvent itself, renew power, was tied to like success on the rugby field. If you have a sports boycott, they can't play anymore. So people are like, nobody likes us, they don't want to play with us. They did have a little moment where they paid people like something like $500,000 to come and play for a month, like cricket players, rugby players, but that didn't last long. And so to a large extent, sport played a role in the end of apartheid. And then just as a quick final point, sport also played a role again when you had like this new South Africa, which is a problematic idea, the end of apartheid, where the Rugby World Cup, I don't know how many of you have seen Invictus, right? Where that becomes again, like you use rugby to make white South Africans feel okay about the change that's coming. So when somebody comes to me and is like, why is sports important? It's an easy answer. I don't have to like struggle to answer that because like sports was so much, it was just part of like the way that I grew up, the way that I existed. And I think it still is now, yeah.
Oh yeah, definitely. And I think that sports also becomes like a language, almost like an ideological Trojan horse, where say you've got somebody in your life who, you can't get through their heads talking about say LGBT issues. They're just not gonna hear you if you come at them with that. Or they just don't wanna hear what you're saying if you think that immigrants should have equal rights in this country. You could tell sports stories about LGBT issues or immigrant rights, and all of a sudden you're having a conversation with somebody who before that was walled off. So it's kind of like a two-pronged effort where you've got people on the left who think that, to like sports, you might as well have Donald Trump's name tattooed across your back and it's the worst thing in the world. And you've got that over there, but then you've got people also who we can have conversations with who otherwise would cut themselves off and have those conversations through sports. And I would make the case like you could name the issue. It doesn't matter even how obscure it is. And we could talk about that issue through sports in a way that has somebody listening to what you have to say when otherwise they might not hear you.
Yeah, one of the best pieces of journalism that I've seen recently that is just basically a sports story, I don't know if you've seen it, David Goldblatt did a piece for The Guardian, part of their long form. The Guardian has this kind of, it's actually a former, I think he used to work for The Nation as an intern, Jonathan Shannon. This is like a long time ago, if there's any of the old nation people here. But he went to a prison in Uganda. I don't know if anybody's seen this, where he hung out with these prisoners who organized a tournament. They organized this kind of, they named themselves Man United, Arsenal, Liverpool, Hanover, Hanover 96. And then they played this tournament sort of over a couple of weekends. So he went into the prison and found out, you know, just by hanging out with them, he found out something about institutional reform, like how you could run a prison differently. Because the head of the prison started talking about in America, in the US, you have guards walking around with guns, or in Britain, you have great ways of monitoring prisoners, but you don't have a way of letting them feel that they are part of they live here, they're gonna be here for a while, and so that they don't feel alienated about the whole experience. And so it's a great piece. I would recommend it. You know, similarly, right now, I think a lot of people have a problem with Vice. I mean, I like Vice, for example. Vice Sports, I think, is doing really great work right now. There's an element of Vice Sports that makes you feel like you're watching the old, I don't know if it was in the US, if it was popular, Trans World Sports, or the equivalent of Wide World of Sports. You know, that kind of like, or sometimes when Salema Masekela, who's actually the son of Hugh Masekela, the musician, when he presents, he sounds like Leap Shriver, you know, the guy who's on HBO. Like, you can almost hear the copying or the way that it sort of segues in. But they're doing great work. They also went to the prison. They've done like another couple of good stories on sports in Ghana. They'll, you know, that nobody else is doing. So, and through this, people are learning about a range of other issues that they wouldn't have touched if you went to them and said, "I would like to do a piece about prisons and institutional reform." They may not want to see that story. But if you, or even on Cuba, they just did a piece on Cuba where they went down and looked at Cuban baseball players who have to leave their country through a third country, either Dominican Republic or Mexico, to come and play in the U.S. And then what this new rapprochement between the U.S. and Cuba means, you know, for that relationship. Yeah.
Yeah. So welcome to Vice Sport. No, I'm just kidding. It's all right. It's all right. But the thing that I find very interesting is that
it's not perfect.
Vice Sports is doing great stuff. There's another site called Vocative that's doing great stuff. Hell, ESPN just started a website called The Undefeated, which is very explicitly, they're like, your place for the intersection of race, sports, culture, and politics. And I find this fascinating because when we started doing this at The Nation, a decade ago, it's like, I mean, we were literally like the ugly stepchild that everybody takes a turn slapping. I mean, it was like no one wants politics and sports, and it was this whole thing where we faced, and I say we because I've never had anything but support at The Nation, so I'm not going to say I, but like we faced a significant backlash for raising questions like about the history of things like South Africa boycott and being like, what boycotts today would matter? How can sports be used today to isolate countries? Should the U.S. be isolated for its prison practices? Should we talk on the international sporting stage? What do we say about that? You know, what do we say about the Olympics? What do we say about the World Cup? What do we say about... And it was not common when we were writing this, and there was an effort to marginalize us. There was an effort to shame us for daring to ruin people's sports. And I think what you've seen in recent years is people get that there is an audience of people who love sports but hate mainstream sports coverage. And they love watching, but they're watching with the sound down. And they want an analysis of sports that's more than skin deep. And they're commodifying that and marketing that and selling that. And no, they don't give a percentage to us at The Nation for being trailblazers in this regard. And that's fine, that's part of the business, and that's cool. And I'm glad that I'm actually thrilled that the pool is bigger and that there's this new generation of people who are like, I wanna write about the politics of sports. I think it's amazing. I wish there were 10 times as many people doing this. But the thing is that we have to be careful too, is that when dissent becomes commodified, what happens is that the sharpness of it also becomes filed down. And so we just have to be like really conscious of that. And you saw this like the day, I don't want to go after specific sites because I see the cameras are rolling, but I'll just say that like that you always have to ask yourself like and this is true of almost any job in journalism, seriously, any paying job, is like, where are the barriers? Where are the walls? And am I self-imposing my own censorship? Or am I actually testing where the walls are? You always want to be a wall tester. And be, you always want to ask, without being a jerk, because this isn't like, here's how you get fired. That's not what I'm here to tell you. So it's like, without being a jerk, you always want to be asking, though, the question, where are the walls? Where are the walls in this place? What can I write about? And far, far, far too many journalists, and I'm talking about people who are like, from starting out to people who are so famous, if they walked in here, we'd all fall over. It's like people create their own censorship. People create their own barriers. People self-censor. And it's the death of journalism when you practice self-censorship. I mean, and too many of these sports sites, that's what I'm saying, is that I loved the Uganda piece, to be clear. I liked the Cuba piece. But it's like that question of what isn't being asked, and is it not being asked because, whether it's not being asked because the journalists feel the walls or whether it's not being asked because their higher ups are saying, no, you can't go there. The bigger question has to do is that this is what you deal with when dissent is commodified.
They'll have like one line maybe. I think in the Cuba piece, there's like one line where you could sort of feel that the journalists would like, wanted to go a little bit more into the subject, but then had to go back to something that you would see on Real Sports, you know, the sort of HBO, that HBO show where you could see like, okay, he wanted to do more, but he wasn't sure whether he could push it. I just have to say at the same time, we should also, and I know that's not what you're doing, but we should, we can't pretend like, oh, there's just like a terrible mainstream. There's been like great journalism from like the Times, when the New York Times did that whole series on what's that ice hockey guy, he was like a bruiser.
Yeah.
And he had all these injuries, and from like his role. I mean, I'm not a big ice hockey fan, but I understand his role was to like beat up on other people, and so he had many concussions. And the Times ran, I think, something like 10,000, 15,000 words on this one. So
the Times does great. So anything short of Fox News, like if any place short of
outside
Fox,
the line, outside
if any
the
place
line.
Short of Fox, and I include ESPN, if any of these places called me tomorrow and were like, we want to hire you, if we have to, we'll put the nation out of business. No, I'm just kidding. But if they were like, we want to hire you and you get control over what you write about, there is probably nowhere, unless the place was so objectionable, like a place like Fox, where I was like, okay, they're only hiring me so when people say to you, hey, you're a disgusting tool of oppression, you don't want to go somewhere where their response would be, no, they're not. No, we're not. We hired Dave. Like, you don't want to be that person for them to justify their existence. But so short of that kind of setup where you're so clearly a political token, there's nowhere you shouldn't work as long as you have the freedom to do what you want to do. New York Times does brilliant work, absolutely. Nation does stuff I disagree with, you know, that I don't like on a decent, sometimes, very rarely. But the point isn't whether we like it or don't like it, agree with it or disagree with it. The point is like how much space does the journalist have to be able to create their own story? And I will say, just so I put a bookend on this, what I truly, truly love about The Nation is, if nothing else, I know when I'm reading something, I'm reading what the writer wanted to explore about the topic with no bullshit. And that's something you don't get in other places where you might see a line in there like, I feel as bad as an individually sliced Kraft brand cheese product. What a terrible thing this, you know, they just throw it in there, you know? It's like, I feel fresher this morning than some Scope mouthwash. And it's just like, wait a minute, wait, what just happened? You know, so there's a lot of...
Sometimes things will happen in the most unusual places. I don't know if you remember this. I think you were on Outside the Line. Yeah. Outside the Lines, maybe I'm getting the title wrong.
Yeah, Outside the Lines.
You and Bomani Jones with this guy, Paul.
Paul Feinbaum,
yeah, where, I don't know if you guys know, he's like Alabama radio, football, right?
Yeah.
And he had said some racist thing, I think. And there was this great showdown, which is like, I was like, oh, I'm watching ESPN. And there's this like great argument between these. I mean, you probably.
That was live television, right? Though. It was unintentional. So
it's unintentional. And it's happening in a forum where ESPN, where a lot of people criticize for not being open to discuss. There are many things that ESPN doesn't want to touch around the NFL or whatever. And then that happened on ESPN. I mean, it was college ball, I know. But like, it can happen in these places that we don't expect.
It was crazy. Paul Feinbaum is a Southern Jewish supporter of the Confederate flag. And so it was me and Bomani Jones, who is a black sports writer and radio broadcaster.
By training. Yeah.
And an economist by training, and from North Carolina. And the two things that he said that Paul Feinbaum, I mean, defending the Confederate flag is bad enough, but he also was being like, this is ridiculous, I'm the only Southerner here. And Bomani was like, I'm as Southern as you, Paul. You know, this idea that he's somehow not Southern. And then, and I was just like, no, Bomani, Paul's, and he also was like sort of like to me, he was like, look, I'm Jewish and I don't mind this Confederate flag. I'm like, I'm Jewish too. And he's like, yeah, you're Jewish. So I'm like, okay, Paul is more Jewish than me. He's blacker than you, Bomani. He's the most black Jewish man in the history of white people. And everybody should listen to what he says. And the thing about it, I'll be honest with you, the thing about it that made it so raw, because I still get asked about that. That's the thing about that made it so raw is, like, one, it was live. Two, it was a replacement host, and we just basically took it over and we're yelling at each other. And you got to see it. Like, we're, like, you literally just, like, yelling. And then the thing that happened, though, right after that, this thing where it's like, you know, like, I walked away being like, yeah, we took that guy, yeah. Like, a month later, like, he got his own show on ESPN. And it's so, it's one of those things too, where you get a lot of that nowadays, where it's like, ooh, we like this hot discussion, we like debate, but then it's like, okay, you like debate, I'm willing to debate, and it's like, ooh, not that debate, that's a little, not that debate, but it was very, and actually, this is an interesting just little coda of the story, and this is just it's like Paul, it was really ugly. Actually, the aftermath of that, the Confederate flag, a little viral clip, it was really ugly. And Paul, like, got in touch with me privately, and we kind of, like, became friends talking, and he talked about it. And then, so now he regularly has me on his very Southern radio show when there's college issues, and it's hilarious, because he throws me, like, three softball questions, like, so the Missouri athletes went on strike against racism, what do you think about that? And I'm like, I think it was awesome. And he's like, okay, what do you think about the precedent it sets? And I'll say, well, it doesn't set precedent. Athletes used to do this all the time in the late 60s. They're picking up the baton, the tradition. You know, there's no reason why black athletes should not enforce their will on a racist institution. And he's like, okay, thank you very much. Now let's take calls. And people call up and they're like, Paul, who was that? And so, you know, it's what you do. And, you know, it's like the expression. It's like you don't go to, you know, you let... Muhammad, was it? I think it's Muhammad shouldn't walk to the mountain, let the mountain come to Muhammad. Yeah. It's like, don't worry about where you work. Worry about whether you can do the kind of writing that you want to do.
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to say one other quick thing should we have like people ask us some throw it open or it might be, but I just wanted to say one other thing that I think often gets forgotten in discussions and debates about sports, which is, one is, I think that people forget how much sports, you know, they're sort of like, oh, let's either write it color pieces or people sort of dabble in the politics of it. But I think one is, I think people forget how much sports has become a business and the amount of money that's involved in sports. I don't know as much. I know a little bit about sort of the way that cities, municipalities provide football teams here with tax exemptions, pay for like the whole stadium, and then they move apparently in the middle of the night to go somewhere else. I think LA just got like a football team from St. Louis or something like that. But I know more about the way it works with soccer, where you have, you know, where there are instances, particularly in some of the European leagues, where people still associate some clubs with some kind of local tradition, and they're holding on, like whether it's Liverpool Football Club or Manchester United or Arsenal. But all these football clubs are now either owned by an oligarch, which are often with very dubious histories in the way that they acquired their wealth, by some oil sheikh out of, you know, particularly from Qatar, Dubai, etc. Again, where these, and again, you know, those states have oil wealth, but there's a lot of questions about labor practices over there, about democracy over there, but nobody has that because people are just buying shirts, the stadiums are looking better. So there's very little, I think, nowadays about... There is a little bit more in book form. I think there's a lot of this kind of writing when you think about soccer, and particularly maybe Simon Cooper or I forgot his name, this guy who writes about a man from Man City. He's a Guardian writer, David I'll get his name later. But there's, you know, there's a little bit, there's a little bit more of that kind of writing. The other thing is FIFA. I mean, I don't have to remind you of like the FIFA story from the last couple of months. But people, the thing about FIFA that's interesting is FIFA is a non-governmental organization. Mm-hmm. It's an NGO. It's an NGO. It's a non-profit. And then secondly, it is probably the most powerful non-profit in the world. It's bigger than the UN. It has more members than the UN. No country, until recently, because you know I teach a class here at the New School on global soccer, and the sort of argument you could like teach this course every semester and basically tell the same old story that you had this non-profit there was very little regulation over it and nobody took it on. And the people running it were really corrupt, down from like whether it was the president until recently, Sepp Blatter, and his predecessor. So they either were racist, or they were just corrupt and corrupt and racist. And then you had now you have this peculiar or extraordinary couple of events where the U.S. government of all people intervenes in football.
Hey, you don't give the U.S. the World Cup, you're gonna get it.
Yeah, so like you know, it's like this interesting moment where you're like, what do you do with this? What does one do with this? Yeah. That it's actually the U.S. that's playing the role of policeman, if you wanted some. So it's like that. Those are the kind of things that often doesn't come out. And then if the U.S. intervenes, what's interesting about it is this is also about how the U.S. is becoming a power in a sport that normally people didn't associate with the U.S. as a power. So you have the U.S. first coming in through its attorney general, and then at some point, I bet you we'll have a U.S. president of FIFA, because U.S. corporations are going to play a bigger role in football. Every summer, every major European team, they're playing some other Emirates Cup or something in the U.S. So those are the things that I think often is missed in the writing about sport. Yeah.
No, I agree. Did we want it? Peter's given us.
I love to hear you guys talk, but if you guys have some questions, why don't you line up here like we did earlier? And we're doing this on the mic so we could get this video recorded. Your questions wouldn't be on our recording if you were not speaking into here. So, your first.
Hi, I'm Alessandro from Syracuse. I'm a huge soccer fan, but I was actually wondering if you believe countries like Brazil and South Africa hosting the World Cup actually do more harm than good when those nations have so many domestic issues and yet spend billions of dollars on stadiums and everything. And then after the tournament, which lasts about a month, stadiums are left empty and they still have ongoing problems. And also, if there's any possibility you see Qatar not hosting the 2022 World Cup.
This is interesting. We got, given the time we have left, we're gonna try to burn through these questions. And then if people want to talk more afterwards, happy to make myself available. But I do want to be able to get through it. First of all, yeah, hosting these mega events do terrible things to countries. It's not exclusively Brazil, South Africa. It's not a global South question. It's wherever they're hosted. Debt, displacement, militarization of public space. It's the common language of hosting these sports mega events, particularly in the post 9/11 era. I've been covering this stuff since 2002. Every Olympics and World Cup, the only thing that changes are the language of the people who are outraged when they finally get the bill that's due. But the one thing that we should also keep in mind is that when we say these things don't make money or aren't successful, we always have to ask the question like, well, they actually are successful for some people, just not everybody. Like John Carlos from the 68 Olympics, he always says, you know why they have the Olympics just every 4 years? Because it takes 4 years to count the money. The problem is that it stays in very few hands. And so the idea of democratizing the process becomes very important as a question going forward. And the question of how to avoid the white elephants, which is the slang for the building structures that just basically rot when the games are done, is also a pressing question coming forward. And it's a development question. And it's one that's only becoming sharper going forward. And we've been covering this in The Nation for a decade. And we're going to do a cover story about Brazil in July. Where I just got back from there. And it's what I saw firsthand. And they're so conscious of it there. I just got to say this quick thing. I know I was just like, I'll do this quickly. I'm sorry. But like, they gave me a tour of one of the Olympic facilities. And they said, like, do you notice how they're shaped? And I noticed there was like, they're all like in these little blocks. And I said, yeah, it looks almost like a a Lego set. And they're like, yeah, exactly. They think of it like a big Lego set. When this is done, what we're going to do is we're going to take it apart piece by piece, and then it's going to be a school in one of the poorer communities. And I'm just sort of like, wouldn't it have just been more effective to build a school rather than a magical stadium that comes apart like Lego and then gets rebuilt as a school? It just seems like, this is a very curious way to go about getting a school.
I just want to say quickly on that question, I agree with everything that Dave is saying, except when I remember going to the 2010 World Cup. So I have a slightly mixed view, which is I look at the World Cup more as a kind of symbolic event, and also with the assumption that like FIFA is corrupt, but I'm a fan. And all that I wanted to do when I went to the World Cup was to enjoy it. And in fact, I remember there were protests in South Africa before the World Cup. I was you know, part of it. I had friends who were organizing it. And I remember asking my brother, who was like, you know, working in a factory, what do you think of these protests? He's like, I don't care. I just want to see the World Cup. Mm-hmm. But this doesn't mean he didn't care about, he knew. Yes, I think what I want to, poor people are not stupid. They're not duped. He knew that like the World Cup wasn't going to transform South Africa. It wasn't going to deal with the fundamental problems of, he knew that FIFA was taking all, you know, they understand that. What he was at least demanding, I think this is probably what happened in Brazil, although it's complicated by sort of class politics and right wing, left wing, but I think there is an aspect where people, they want accountability from their government, and they want their government to do, as you said, build schools and whatever, and they don't necessarily think that World Cups and things like that are magic bullets that are going to transform their societies.
And the bullshit really gets old. Like, I was in South Africa for a while, but way in the advance of the World Cup, when a lot of the propaganda was coming in, and the amount of bullshit that people rolled their eyes at was an almost daily occurrence, because the kind of promises that were made, which is like, first the stadiums today, the hospitals tomorrow. That's what one of the people said. And people, it's not just like me as this outsider being like, oh, that's so silly. Like, people living there are like, bullshit. It was very upsetting. Because I think that there's so much fat that could be cut off hosting these events. And part of that fat is just this bureaucracy of promise makers who try to act like hosting a sporting event is somehow a toboggan ride to development.
How's it going, guys? I'm Alex. First question. So did Steph get benched after last night? We started Sean Livingston on Sunday? Yeah? Okay.
No, we'll get them both, and then I'll answer.
Wait. So I think, Sean, you brought up a really interesting point about South Africa being banned from playing, barred from playing rugby in the international community to kind of as an ends to apartheid. My question is, and then David followed up saying that, U.S. should do something similar like that, like banning U.S. My question is that feasible? Because I think what makes the U.S. so unique is that we have this kind of, whereas most countries mostly focus on soccer or cricket or rugby as like a one sport country, the U.S. is like obviously has like a wide variety of different sports, obviously football like being like a large like domination of that. But do you think it's like feasible to make as much political change in the U.S. as in other countries with sports, just because of like the wide variety of options people have?
I'll have a quick answer and then I'll let you. My quick answer to that, it depends on whether the sport matters in a particular country. So As you rightly say, it would be very difficult. I know that there's now people who claim that soccer is really important in the United States. We don't have the time to debate this. Soccer actually has a very deep history here that people often discount and pretend like, oh, nobody plays soccer in the U.S. Actually, it has a very deep history. But the quick answer is, it depends on like how important the nation's national identity is tied to its success, like in sporting events, in, if you want, like a community of the world. You're right, in the US you have these tournaments that are called world championships, which you're playing against yourself and singing national anthems to yourself. So it would be much more difficult. Aubrey is in the audience, we wrote a piece for The Nation actually, debating the question about, whether it's feasible to have like a sports boycott against Israel. And one argument that people also make about Israel is like, with the exception of soccer, it's not that Israel's good in soccer, but Israel's national identity and its identity of wanting to belong to a world, to like say, hey, we're not a rogue state, we belong to a world community of states, we belong to UEFA, that's actually important, that's part of Israeli identity, and Israel sees itself as kind of like an outpost of Western civilization.
Yeah, UEFA is the European.
Right, the European Football Association. So in that instance, it would matter, But it's, I think maybe Dave has a different answer, but I think it would be harder to make that answer around sports here. Maybe with track and field or the Olympics, but I'm not sure.
I mean, it's a very, very concrete tactical question for activists about where you want to flex the muscle of the experience of apartheid South Africa, and do you think it's going to work? And the one of the aftermaths of the apartheid experience was that organizations like FIFA and like the IOC, they passed declarations, and they called them declarations against apartheid in sports, just so there would be no mixed thoughts whatsoever, that like basically like, look, we're not going to pass political judgment on any nation unless there is a conscious, organized way that keeps people from playing because of who they are. That's the, like, sporting organizations, they drew that line in the sand. Now, what if someone wanted to say, why does the U.S. get to compete in some of these competitions, given the ways in which physical education programs, boys and girls clubs, athletic opportunities for poor people have diminished dramatically over the last generation? Isn't that a way that you're denying people the opportunity to play sports? And so it's a question. And obviously the question of Israel and Palestine, which I've written about at great length and never with an iota of censorship whatsoever at The Nation. And I say that because that actually really does matter, that I've always had support in writing these articles, because you do not get that everywhere. Trying to explore this idea about like, okay, so there are athletes in Gaza and the West Bank who can't leave to play an international competition. Doesn't that violate the international dictates around apartheid that were passed in the aftermath of South Africa? And can we raise that as an example, as a way to also, like what we started this discussion talking about the universality of sports? And like, I've written articles for the Nation where I said, like, imagine if Kobe Bryant got kidnapped by Canada and was held in prison. Would that be a story? Well, guess what? A soccer player from Gaza who's on the national team is kidnapped and he's in a prison and no charges have been brought against him. What if that had happened to Kobe Bryant? Would that be a sports story that we would discuss? Gee, I think it would be. Why is nobody talking about this particular case? So, if you use that in every case, and just like, you don't want to become the journalist who shouted apartheid either, because then you could also serve to diminish the South African experience as well as the experience of people who were able to use sports so effectively. But I think it's totally appropriate to bring up in the Israel-Palestinian context. And I also think, as someone who lives in this country that is has so many savage inequalities, the idea of constantly looking at this country under that kind of a magnifying glass and looking at sports as a way to expose those inequalities, I think that's a duty of journalism.
This is a quick point, which is necessarily not sports, but like, you could see where people have tried this tactic. So Michael Brown, his mother, Michael Brown from Ferguson, his mother and stepfather, I think, went to Geneva, I think late last year, to go and make a submission to a UN panel on torture. And their whole argument was, we are going to shame the United States at an international forum. And similarly, in post-war history in the United States, some African-American activists have tried to use this idea of saying, I mean, the Panthers tried it, I think, in the early 70s when they said they would like the UN should supervise a referendum over, the right for their right to succeed in the United States. I mean, there's instances where people have used the language, that kind of language of these international organizations that come up with these broad condemnations and stuff. But these things are also full of contradictions, it's like, so, and Israel has also a way of kind of playing these up, like where FIFA will say, if FIFA says we're going to ban Israel, then Israel supporters will say, well, what are you going to do about Iran that's keeping women out of stadiums? So there's all kinds of, there's also a way in which, where you said you sat apartheid at everything, like with many of these things, they mean everything and they mean nothing. Mm-hmm. They've come to mean like nothing. There's also a way in which they've become kind of empty.
So I'm Adam, I'm from Wake Forest. I just have a very quick question for Dave. So I read your book, What's My Name, Fool? And I was impressed, I loved it. And I was very impressed with a lot of the unconventional yet strongly supported arguments that you had made in the book, whether it was your analysis of the death of Pat Tillman or why the media didn't pick up on the retirement of Mia Hamm or your opinion about Barry Bonds and his absence of steroid use. So I was just wondering if you had advice for us student journalists on how we can, tackle conventional wisdom and how we can have, you know, the same kind of intellectual courage that you have in what you write, even though the mainstream may disagree with some of the opinions you've presented.
Damn,
beautiful love letter.
Yeah, courage is a strong word. Courage is a very strong word. I mean, the number one thing, and I apologize to everybody who was in the workshop we did before for being repetitive, but the number one thing is, honestly, it's like, don't take for granted that you have a voice, because your voice is constantly evolving, your voice is constantly developing, and your voice is 99% sweat equity. So it's like, and that means the very basic, most important advice in the world is never stop writing. So let's say you got a job and you're a photo editor somewhere, you're doing web design or whatever it is you got to do in journalism to put food on the table. Never stop writing. Don't assume that you're gonna like be 30, get your big break, and then all of a sudden, you know, the writing chops you had when you were 19 are 11 years better, because it's just, it will not work out that way. And so it's like, all I know about what I write is that I try to tell my truth, and all I know is that the ability that I have to tell my truth has nothing to do with anything other than the fact that whether I was working, opening doors at a hotel, or interning at a union in DC, I mean, I was always writing at all times. And you know what's the coolest thing about that? Is that, you know, we live in this really fucked up society where you go to a party or something, the first thing you're always asked is, what do you do? Because people want to define you in 10 seconds based on that answer. What do you do? Hate that shit. What do you do? And to be able to look at people and just be like, I'm a writer, is to me like the ultimate this to that question. Because being a writer requires no sanction from anybody. While I work at Goldman Sachs is a very different kind of an answer.
Hi, my question for Sean is, given the rise of Roads Must Fall and Fees Must Fall in South Africa, do you think that sports still has a role to play in decolonization and transformation, particularly in sports like rugby and cricket, which still remain like resoundingly white? And then my question for Dave is, I haven't read your book on Ali, but I'm keen to know what your thoughts were on Dave Remnick's book, King of the World, which also focused on Ali, because I had thoughts and I was keen to know what you thought.
So quickly, for people who don't know, in South Africa right now, the sort of the framing, so it's been 20 years since the end of apartheid, right? That you had a deal between the former oppressors and the new government, which is the ANC. That deal is being questioned now by young people, people who have no lived experience of apartheid, but have lived through this through freedom, and freedom is insufficient. These are mostly like students initially at the, actually, I mean, this is too much inside of baseball, but like mostly at the historically black universities, which are the universities which are not as well resourced. But this, the struggle really became, like you read about it or saw it on the news, when at a series of what in South Africa like are like elite universities, like the former white universities, where students began to protest around symbols, like, you know, statues, etc. And they, you remember when they removed this statue called, the statue of Sozo Rhodes. Now, at the same time in South Africa, there's also a struggle, and there's a constant tug of war over sports symbols. The rugby team was named the Springboks. I mean, I actually don't call them the Springboks. I don't think I ever can, because of, I actually played rugby in high school, so I know a little bit about that stuff. But the point is, the rugby team, in 1995, when they won that World Cup, remember the Invictus movie that I mentioned? Mm-hmm. Only one of the players was black, a winger. 3 years later, Nelson Mandela, he's always portrayed as a reconciler, and I know a lot of the Roads Must Fall people, they don't have a great view of him, but he actually took the rugby union to court because they had failed to transform, and he went, I mean, people, when they talk about that moment, they talk mostly about how he subjected himself to the rule of law, and this showed that he wasn't going to be a dictator. Fine, but it was actually about him saying, you didn't transform. But so what has happened, I think, to quickly just end this, like, I think what's happened with the way sport plays into the struggle, like recently, there's two incidents I can recall. One is a group of students from one of the universities went to a soccer game of the two most popular football clubs in South Africa. One is called the Orlando Pirates, which is and the other is Kaizer Chiefs. And they tried to disrupt the game by running onto the field, and they were actually beaten up by some of the fans. So it wasn't a very, given the history of disrupting sports to prove political points in South Africa, it was actually not a great experience. And the second one was at a rugby game at a university in sort of the, what they call the heartland, which is the middle part of the country, very conservative part of the country, conservative whites. A group of students went and protested there. It's called the University of the Free State, very ironic name. And as they were protesting, running on the field, a group of white students came and beat them up. And you can watch this video on YouTube. Nothing came of the attackers. The police said, oh, we'll investigate. So at this point, I think there isn't much debate and discussion. It's actually an interesting question that maybe I should think about more, that there hasn't been really questions about, like, how can we link up questions around these symbols on campuses with symbols to do with sport, whether it's like the Springbok as a symbol or the composition of the team. I think it's interesting to look at what's happened here. So, like, in a way, I think a lot of students here at Yale, I think at Harvard, picked up on the Rhodes Must Fall movement in South Africa and started agitating around symbols here. But I think here the South African students can actually take lessons from some of the struggles here around sports and sports symbols and integrating teams that has happened in Missouri, or, you know, if you want to go back to the 1960s, that where South African students can actually take a lead from people here.
Yeah. Remnick's book, in a lot of respects, it's interesting, because I'm sorry, it's over on my phone. I got all these people tweeting me and texting me that Ali's in the hospital. So it's interesting mm-hmm. to ask that question. But that the situation's worsened. So I was like trying to deal with this simultaneously, which is not easy. But to me, Remnick's book is inferior to a book by Mike Marcosi called Redemption Song, Muhammad Ali and the Spirit of the 60s. Because the biggest problem that you can do with Muhammad Ali's story is to decontextualize it. So if it becomes this story about Ali's legend, then it turns into Jack and the Beanstalk. See, this is they're calling about Ali right now. But I'll hold off on this. Okay. And we'll do it. Hey, Dave Zirin here. I'll do this publicly. Yeah. Doing great. I'm in front of about 70 journalists. I'm bad at numbers. 600? 50? I don't know. Something. But I took the call because of Ali. The nation's doing something. I'm here at the new school. They're students, man. I'm gonna put you on the mic. Say hi to everybody.
You in your class?
I don't have a class. No one would hire me to teach. But they have me here to talk, and it's awesome. So I'm very happy to be here. Yeah, why don't I call you back? I'll call you back on this number in a few minutes.
Thank you.
No problem. Wow, he sounded thrilled. Yes.
So I grew up playing sports, and I'm a sports fan. And last year at my university, I wrote several pieces about, the history of sports and sexism, specifically one surrounding the athletic field at the center of campus and the way that it historically excluded women and it still does. And then I wrote recently an opinion piece also, basically, I guess, calling for the sports world to try to respect women more. And I started the piece talking about the way sports media, I guess mainstream media, coverage the whole fiasco with Nick Young and D'Angelo Russell earlier this year, mm-hmm. and the way that they basically, like Stephen A. Smith said, when it comes to women, you just turn the other way, and stuff like that. And I was actually fairly discouraged, though, because after I published the article, some of my teammates on the hockey team came up to me and said, like, I don't disrespect women. Like, I have a sister. Like, I would never do that. And, like acting like, oh, like it was a personal attack on them, which when I was talking about sports culture as a whole. And obviously I thought, and my other friends were like, yeah, they're just idiots, like, whatever. But it was discouraging because I was thinking, yeah, like, I can write this about sports and I can be critical, but is it actually going to do anything, because if nobody listens or really seriously considers my point of view, then what am I actually achieving? And so this applies to all journalism in general, is like, how do you write journalism that can like affect social change and raise awareness in a real way?
Well, it's like, I go back sometimes, I get those big questions to John Carlos, who again, he was a 1968 Olympian, raised his fist on the medal stand. We did his memoir together and then traveled together. So it was like a lot of late night talking and whatnot. And I said to him, it's like, what do you do if you feel like you're doing something and putting yourself out there and you're not moving people? You know, like what, you just feel like you're shoveling sand in the ocean, basically. And John said to me, he said, I'm not interested in what people think. I'm interested in what that one person thinks. And if I could change even just that one person, then we're actually moving in a better direction, because who knows who that one person is going to change and whatnot. So it's like, you can't, you know, it's easy to say stuff like, let your haters be your motivators or whatnot, but what it's, you know, because it's always easy to focus on the people who send you the nasty shit and to focus on that and to be demoralized by it. And what's much harder is to actually hone in on the person who you changed and the person who you influenced, and to see value in that and a lasting value in that, that you don't dismiss out of hand because five people said to you that what you did was wrong.
I mean, just on the on gender and sport, I think one of the things that we have to do around that is just to like normalize the way that we, that people, you know, relate to sport. So for example, and again, you know, it's like when I said earlier, it's easy to sort of say ESPN this or ESPN that. I think ESPN, for example, during, I think it was the 2014 World Cup, what was her name, Julie Foudy, where they made her one of their anchors, and they wasn't like, they didn't make like a whole song, you know, they didn't kind of like, oh, she's special. No, it was like, she's a pundit, done. I think if that's the way to get around this. Secondly, I have a young son, like 6-year-old, and I watch like how they, like how him and his peers relate to football, like the Women's World Cup that happened in Canada, I think it was last year. Just a very different, I think sometimes this is about unlearning some of our own prejudices when you're sort of explaining about your, I don't know where the question, where he went, but there is, like just, it's almost like to unlearn, like when you say like, oh, so I have a sister, and no, it's like, it's unlearning a lot of those prejudices and just watching how my 6-year-old kind of relate to the game and watching the game with him. I think that's another step that people need to take. So I think it's like normalizing like how we talk about sport and women and sport. It's sometimes often treated as like, oh, it's another subject that we add on to. When I was coming here, I wrote down like what are things that are covered badly, and I, for example, women's football on the African continent is one of them, like soccer, mm-hmm. Where women's football on the African continent only gets covered when it's like homophobia within the Nigerian national team. And that's terrible. I mean, I'm not saying, you know, there's nothing great about that. Or whereas in South Africa, where there's where there's often like objectifying women who play football as lesbians, and then they violently get attacked. But there's other ways to also talk about women's football that you don't just have to write those stories. Secondly, it's there's terrible coverage about Caster Semenya, yeah. You know, the South African athlete. So if there's a challenge, I think, for this generation of journalists is to like take on people like Stephen A. Smith, who I think is terrible. You know, like I think that's what will be great. And then just finally, I think the internet has done a lot in countering that kind of. So when Stephen A. Smith makes a fool of himself, there's like a lot of websites that you can go to, like alternative websites, sites that have sprung up and that are way more, that are progressive, that can provide you with better information about those same topics. So you don't have to go, what's it called again, the show that he's on? First Take. You don't have to watch First Take. Yeah.
Which is good.
We're not going to interrupt your questions. We're running out of time, sadly. So if you guys could please be as succinct as you can, I know you will be. They're the ones that need to be a little more succinct. Yeah.
Sorry.
Hey.
I'm Shauna. I'm from the New School as well. Sean, you can be obviously expecting this question because I give it to you all the time. So I'm going to push you a little bit harder on that last question. I came up here to talk about women. We've been talking about this for about an hour, and it took a student's question to even address women in sport. So, and then the answer was kind of very general. So my question is, what are you individually writing about with regard to women in sport and the kind of intersection of how women are valued or devalued by sports, particularly in international affairs and stuff like that?
I mean, so I'm not a journalist. I occasionally write, but when I do, as I said, I run this website, Africa as a Country. I would recommend that you go look at it. Actually, Shauna is part of it. She's asking me that question. But we do also have a smaller site. Well, it's not a site, it's like a page, and we have a Twitter account called Football is a Country. And on that site, when I was talking about normalizing the way we talk about sport, we make no distinction about, you know, men's sport, women's sport. In fact, earlier today, we put up a tweet about a project, a photo project from South Africa called Disky Queens. Disky is like, I don't know, like Joga Bonito, you know, like beautiful, like the Brazilian street football. And we were celebrating an all-woman team from Johannesburg. It's a series of photographs by a Johannesburg photographer. So, like, our aim is, you know, we do something deliberate, the way we've done. So it's just like every day we it's myself and another man, but every day we remind ourselves that we need to unlearn, like, how we cover sports. That is not just when we tweet about it, when we write about it, that we should not just, you know, cover men's football, English EPL, whatever. We should try to broaden our own perspective, yeah. But we do it, like, actively.
Two things. One is, yeah, to talk about the politics of sports without talking about the role of women in sports is a non-starter. Then it's not really a discussion about the politics of sports at all. So the ways that I try to deal with it, the Nation, is two. One is being explicitly conscious of what I'm writing about. And so because it's very easy to subconsciously, because the sports world is so incredibly sexist and monochromatic in terms of men's sports coverage, and because women's sports coverage today is actually less than it was 30 years ago. It's like there is, which is stunning when you look at the numbers. It's that there has to be a way in which you take the time to take a step back and actually look at what you're writing about and what you're not, so you don't fall into patterns. That's one thing. The second thing is we started this thing called the Edge of Sports series. So it's not just about writing about women, but about cultivating women sports journalists. So it's not like all on me to be like the Nation sports guy and cover every base, but to actually get more writers with different perspectives, because perspective matters. It's not merely about what we're writing about, it's about who's doing the writing. And that's a very important part of all journalism and the journalism of the future as well. So that's the second part of the story. And the third part, and this is really important, and I wrote a piece earlier this year that actually was the number one read thing on the site, and I didn't think it would be at all, but it was called something like Why I'm Done Defending Women's Sports. And the whole point of the article is, like, I'm tired of women's sports when it is discussed. It is always discussed under the framework of something that's worthwhile or something that should be defended. And we live in a time when Serena Williams is the sports person of the year. We live in a time where the Women's World Cup got higher ratings than the World Series. And so in reality, we live in a time where Sasha Banks is just running shit in professional wrestling. So it's like to look at sports from a mindset that says women's sports needs to be defended, women's sports needs to be justified, instead of celebrating the fact that people are going around the traditional sports media to consume women's sports, is, I think, a perspective that more sports writing needs to start to take. So that's the way that at least we try to deal with it at the Nation and confront it at the Nation. It has to be about journalism, it has to be about the approach, and it has to be about me being self-conscious about my own existence in a sexist sports culture.
Hi. This is a more contemporary question regarding the debate around retiring Roberto Clemente's jersey number in Major League Baseball. And I'm kind of curious to see what your guys' opinion is on this debate and whether it should even be a debate. And then kind of in regards to Clemente's impact on baseball, if athletes can still separate the money from making a political statement like Clemente did during his 20-year career.
It should be retired. It's number 21, retire it everywhere. And I've written about that for The Nation too. And the argument for retiring it, it has to do with the fact, like, baseball retired Jackie Robinson's number 42 in parks across the country, and baseball loves to bathe itself in its civil rights history. And the commissioner, Bud Selig, even said baseball understood civil rights before the civil rights movement. And when he said that, I just wanted to punt him right in the privates, because it's like, you go back and you look at the history of baseball and integration. I mean, it was done over the screaming, kicking bodies of Major League Baseball owners, not with their welcoming assurances of some sort of racial utopia. And quotas on race existed in baseball till the early 70s. And yet now we live in a time where African American participation in baseball is at an all-time low at every conceivable level. And so it's very safe to celebrate Jackie Robinson. What would actually speaks to baseball's future is, like, you retire Clemente, the first language Spanish-speaking superstar in Major League Baseball history. That's a way you confront the racism that plagues baseball today, the anti-immigrant bullshit, the fact that there are several teams that are in states that have papers please laws where people can ask you for your papers at any time. And so if baseball, this is what I've written about repeatedly, is like, if baseball really gave a shit about being part of the civil rights tradition, they would understand that it's not just a tradition, but something that lives in the present tense. And if that was the case, they would honor their Latino history and also defend their current Latino players who have to play in a absolutely frightening anti-immigrant climate in numerous states around this country.
Yes, I too am a huge soccer fan, and both of you were talking about the United States having a bigger role today with corporations, but I couldn't help but think of countries such as Qatar and China. In the former case, they're hosting the 2022 World Cup, bringing people, if I remember correctly, to live there, have children, to have a team for the 2022 World Cup. In the latter's case, the leader of China, Xi Jinping, is a huge soccer fan and really wants to invest more in the country's league. What effect do you think these countries have on the global game in general?
What you're referring to is, like, I don't know if people know, like, Qatar, I think, and a number of other Gulf states, they would, like, buy athletes in track and field. So you'll see, like, somebody pop up who, like, used to run for Kenya, and now they run under a different name. I mean, it's a long shot. I think they won't necessarily win like a World Cup or something. But I think it goes back to my earlier comments about how I always like to say that in order to have a country, you need, like, a football team. Then you've arrived. I think now it's increasingly to show that you've arrived, particularly countries on the margins, you know, developing countries, is that you show that you could put up a mega sports event. China can put up the Olympics, Qatar can do the World Cup. This shows that you've arrived. I mean, that was a story in South Africa. The South African regime, well, they're not really a regime, they're a democratically elected government. Their whole thing was to show, hey, look, we can put up a World Cup. This shows we're first class. And then lastly, I think there is an argument that because sports, increasingly professional sports, it's a lot more about, like, you know, it was always about money, but now the whole reason for existing is just money. And so there's a kind of, we look towards China, and there's a cynical way of, like, buying players. Like, I think Tottenham Hotspur or somebody just signed a Korean player, and that's because they want to sell jerseys in Korea. You know, the player might be good, but it's very cynical the way this stuff works. So at the one end, I think it's to do with, like, it shows we've arrived. And then finally, it's also a form of soft power. In the case of Qatar, this is all about, like, we buy a team or we sponsor a team. Abu Dhabi does the same thing with Paris Saint-Germain. This shows that this is how you're going to be a power. You don't have the capacity of the U.S. to police people. But this is how you can influence people by buying football teams, by funding, you know, projects. Yeah.
Cool. Sorry about this. I feel really bad.
I don't know what he's doing on his phone.
No, I'm trying to see if Muhammad Ali is still with us. I mean, this is.
Oh.
Yeah.
Is it that close?
It's that close.
Oh. Maybe we should have a moment of silence, but not yet if it's not.
Not if he's not dead.
No, no.
Jesus Christ, man.
Anyway, I hate to be the one to end this conversation because I have like 10 questions I would love to ask them. I know all of you too. I appreciate you guys all being so succinct with the questions. They couldn't have been sharper. Again, we were going to talk all week about, again, the questions you guys have brought here because they've been really, really impressive. We've learned from it.